May the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
May the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to church. We're very grateful and thankful to welcome Pastor Jackson Choi back with us this morning. Let's all stand and join together in our opening hymn to God Be the Glory. For this Sunday, our theme is Dead to Sin, Alive in Christ.
Let's remain standing as Alex and Tim leads us in our praise and worship this morning. Succeed. The eternal dishonor will never be forgotten. Lord of hosts, you test the righteous. You see the heart and the mind. Let me see your retribution upon them. For to you I have committed my cause. Sing to the Lord, praise the Lord, for he has delivered the life of the needy from the hands of evildoers. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let's join together, saying Psalm 69, verses 8 to 11 and 18 to 20. And we should, there's only six verses, so let's say this in unison. Surely, for your sake, I have suffered reproach,
and shame has covered my face. I have become a stranger to my own kindred, an alien to my mother's children. Zeal for your house is eating me out. The scorn of those who scorn you has fallen upon me. I humble myself and ask you, but let me turn to my reproach. Answer me, O Lord, for your love is my heart. In your great compassion, turn to me. Hide not your face from your servant. Be swift and answer me, for I am in distress. Draw near to me and redeem me. Because of my enemies, deliver me.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Now our second reading is read this morning from the Gospel.
Today's second reading is taken from the book of Romans, chapter 6, verses 1b to 11. Should we continue in sin in order that grace may abound? By no means. How can we who died to sin go on living in it? Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Therefore, we have been buried with him by baptism into death, so that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body of sin might be destroyed and we might no longer be enslaved to sin. For whoever has died is free from sin, but if we have died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. The death he died to sin, once for all. But the life he lives to God. So you also must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let's all stand and sing our graduate hymn. You are holy.
Thank you. gospel all of you. Do not fear those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Rather fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny, yet not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father. And even the hairs of your head are all counted. So do not be afraid. You are of more value than many sparrows. Everyone, therefore, who acknowledge me before others, I also will acknowledge before my Father in heaven. But whoever denies me before others, I also will deny before my Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to bring peace to the earth. I have not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to set a man against his father, and a daughter against his mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law, and one's spouse will be members of one's own household. Whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me, and whoever loves sons or daughters more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever does not take up the cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Those who find their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. The gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Alleluia. Today, for some of us, it's kind of sad.
Renee and Bryson, who have been with us for not near long enough, will be leaving very, very soon. So this is the last Sunday with us, I believe. So take extra time to say goodbye to Renee and Bryson, especially Bryson's kind of cool. You know? You got it. Congratulations to all of our recent graduates from our congregation. We have Johnny, my son, who's home in bed asleep. And Julia, is she here today? Who has COVID? She is excused. And those from Mac, we have Rico, who probably is also home in bed asleep.
Thailand.
Oh, he's in Thailand in bed asleep. Isla, who I think has departed us for Canada, and special prayers and congratulations to Ellis, who also graduates this year. Let's all stand and join hands and sing our dismissal song as we send the kids on a merry way. Or Amazon.
Facebook for the older folks. We think we are cool on Facebook, so we can take pictures of ourselves.
Say that we are modern. But in fact, they are already in the post modern.
I think IT is already outdated, man. It's hard to keep up. Who's your master? Some of you, maybe your master, we put down when you go for Facebook or this channel or TikTok. If you don't know what I'm talking about, you're good. We go for some teachings, right? We keep Ron's teaching. Oh, Roman Buffett is my teacher. But you know what? The fact is that if your teacher, the end result of your teacher will be your end result if you follow your teacher. So that if you follow Roman Buffett, your end result will become so poor that you're only left with money. Think about that. If your teacher is somebody who is very wealthy in money terms, at some point you will become very poor that you're only left with money. Jesus said that the student like the teacher. Who's our master? Who's our master? If you follow your master, then your end result will like your master. This is not just a promise, but it's a fact. It's a law. Just like the law of gravity. Just like that. So that today we're looking about how we can follow our master. How our master deal with things. How our master make choices. You know that God made us all to make choices. Do you know why? Do you know why God like us to make choices? Why not just make one tree instead of two? Right? If make only one tree, then we all will live forever and no need to be in sin and ask us to forgive our sin, right? We think that way. But as parents, well, we understand, we want our children to make their own what? Their own choice. So that we can reward them. Not to punish. And then, God make us to have one relationship with us. The relationship is a love relationship. And in love relationship, there's only one component that needed. It's free will. And the free will is making choices. So that when you make choices, for example, just my beautiful wife is here. Imagine this. So ship us before we get married, put us in on an island. Nobody is there. Okay? I'm the only handsome guy. Not in the room, but yeah, he's the guy. I'm the only male in the island. And then I walk up to her and say that. You can marry any man on the island. Any that you choose. Freely choose. But I'm the only one. And you can love any man on this island. Is it really a true choice? No. No. That's why God, when he you know, God had to make a possibility for us not to love him. And the tree of good and evil is that choice, is that little choice. You know what? Before we eat the fruit of good and evil, there's no good and evil. We don't need to know. There's no need of that knowledge. Because From day one, all the children in the Sunday school, they know it. In the day one, God created everything and God said, it is good. On the second day, I forgot what God created. He kept creating things. And the second day, he said, it is
good.
Good. I don't know why he had to use all these days, you know, just create everything, boom. The third day, it's good. The third day is good. The sixth, and then all the way to the 6 days, good. Anything bad? Doesn't exist. You know, in order for something called illegal, the legality have to happen. Back to the time of Adam and Eve, there's no legal or illegal, everything is legal. Only one rule. We think that the only one rule is to not eat the fruit from that tree. That's what we think. But that actually the one rule is to set apart who we are and who God is. There's only one rule. The rule is, are you God or is he God? So simple. We always keep thinking that, oh, the rule is to eat from the tree or not eat from the tree, you know? No, the rule is, are you God or am I God? Because sometimes we feel like we are God. Because we are made in the image of him. So that if your master, if you follow yourself as a master, then you have a very finite thing to learn, is that who is infinite? And are you God? Or is he God? So that, you know, there's two trees. Remember there's two trees in the Garden of Eden? There's two trees, okay? Is that right? No, there's more than two trees. There are two trees that God created all these things, okay? Trees of lychee. Oh, I think a lot of all the spread things. And then I like to play with my son, like he used the phone, and then I'll use his leg like a phone, and every time I use it, hello, I'll use his leg, and he'll always say, Papa, I want watermelon. I don't know why, it's like that. Every time it's watermelon. Do I look like I open a fruit shop or something? All the trees, and then God saying that you can freely choose what you like. You know why God like this? Because God is a father. We always forgot that he's a father. We always think he's a judge. You know? We always think that he's a secret police from the communists. You know? Did you do this today? Okay. Oh, you went to that website. Oh, my God. Oh, you overbuy stuff from your credit card again. Oh, you said something about your neighbor. We think God is like this, you know? And then every Sunday we just come, and then Pastor Stephen, I have this. And then Pastor Stephen, oh, I did this. And then Pastor Stephen says, it's okay, God, okay. We always think God is like this. But remember, always remember, the Trinity is what is the first head of the Trinity? You know that. You can say out loud. I'm just going to trick question. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. What is the first two head of the Trinity telling us what this is about? What concept, what context is it between the Father and the Son? Is it in the courtroom? Family. He's your Father. So this Father is a provider, he's trying to provide. And then in the introduction of the Garden of Eden, God said that you can freely eat from all fruit, freely eat. It's free. So that, but there's two trees. this tree of life, and then this tree of knowledge of good and evil? Don't eat that one. So you don't get it. Let me try another example. I have a son that is 6 years old. Okay. So after I go home, then I tell him, okay, this ice cream and all the stuff in the fridge, you can freely eat. I would never say that, but just pretend I would. You can freely eat. There's some poison for the mice, for the mouse, for the rats. Don't eat that. There's cake. There's the delicious cake in the fridge. I didn't say you eat it or not, but I just introduced that to you. Okay? There's cake, beautiful cake in the fridge. There's poison, don't eat it. Which one of the father wants you to eat? Now you start getting in Genesis why God introduced these two trees to you. So, you know, God had to wait for you to make that choice. You know, there's two trees. There's a tree of life, and this is not the end. So it's all about choice. It's all about choice. We have to make the choice. Every day, our life, it doesn't matter if you're Christians or not, you're making choices. But God wants you to make the good choice that He is God and we are not. So that He gives us a book called Bible. Give us a guidance of how should we make choices. Do you know that this book will give us abundance? Do you know that His law, His rules, it's not something just barely for us to let us follow, but to give us benefits, not just spiritual benefits. So that follow God, follow Jesus, follow His teaching as your master. He will give you life, and then you make good choices. If I am able to find the verse, then I am not taken. Yes. Second, do you know that He loves you so much that He don't just count your hair? In the Bible, you right here say that all your hairs on your head are counted. So that imagine that every night when you sleep, that there's an angel or God Himself coming. 1, 2, 3. There would be two troubles, right? You know? Maybe there's a hair counting machine. It's just like a money counting machine. You have a stack of hair, you know. But what will happen when I get old, you know? The time will take shorter, you know. No, that's not what the Bible said. In the Old Testament, in the original Hebrew, it said that your hair are numbered. Well, our older men understand what our hair is numbered means. No, it means that this here is Jensen D149. What does that mean? It means that God cares about every single piece of cell, even a hair. He loves us so much. But sometimes we don't understand. We think He is a police that watching us. I've been a Christian for 4 generations, not me, but I'm the 4th generation Christian, so my children are the 5th. On both sides. Right? So even my wife is. So that I've been a Christian for so long, I read the Bible, I know God loves me, we always sing that, and then, but I don't really understand His love sometimes. So that when I was in the United States, I was working already, and then I was in a stage of loss. I was so lost, and then I went to gamble as a habit. So that my parents gave me about $60,000 US for me to buy a house back then. Now I can only buy a parking space. And then I went to casinos. I was playing Texas Hold'em. Who knows how to play Texas Hold'em? Don't raise your hands. It's safest. And then I to a point that now that I lost all 60,000, now I owe another 60,000. So almost $1 million MOP, almost. And then I remember I was so lost. And then at the point that I don't know what I'm doing. I still believe God exists. I still believe God loves me, but I don't really know what that means. So I remember that day when I took the two card of Hold'em, if you know what I'm talking about, that's bad. Take the two card, I still remember those two cards, 10 free of suit, 10 of spade and 3 of diamonds. I still remember those two cards. All of a sudden, so this is the beginning, all of a sudden, God spoke to me. All of a sudden, on the casino, on the gaming table, I thought that God missed me on Sunday at church. He spoke to me and said that even the situation and the sin you are in today, my love for you hasn't changed a bit. Wow. My hairs are counted, unnumbered. His love doesn't change. I'm not saying that as we read the Romans today, I'm not encouraging you to sin, but I'm encouraging you, if you're in sin, it doesn't change His love for you. He loves you the same. Doesn't mean that love has no punishment, or love has no consequence. Sin has its own consequence. But God's love doesn't change. When I was, after that, I repent and somehow become a minister. And then even in the first 2 years of me becoming a minister, still not a very good one. And today I'm still not a very good one, still learning. But at that those days, I'm a very bad minister. You know what a bad minister do? They don't read their Bible. He don't pray. I don't really focus on God. So one day, I went to a retreat. In this retreat, this the leader said, okay, now we're going to relax and try to invite God to talk to us. I said, oh, those kind of things again. Come on. Okay, so you quiet down yourself, feel yourself, and then you just close your eyes and imagine that you are a priest in the Old Testament and waiting on the Lord. That's what I mean, what that means. Waiting for the Lord. So I do all those. Okay? So I just sit there, close my eyes, and wait for Jesus to come. I waited. All of a sudden in my mind, He came. It shocked me. Literally came. And then the first word that in my mind that He said is, I waited for you for a long time. How would your reply be when you go home and your wife say that I waited for you for a long time? Or your parents, after school, you went off to party for too long and you go home and you open the door, your father is sitting on the couch, I waited for you for a long time, what will you do? You start apologizing, right? And then in my heart I say that, I say that, Jesus, I'm sorry. I didn't pray enough. I didn't read Bible enough. I didn't do good deeds enough. I didn't do all those. I keep saying I'm sorry. God. To avoid that, I think it's okay, you know. Then, what would you do when you actually meet Jesus face to face? What would you do? Of course, you have to ask him for something, right? Your biggest need in your heart, you ask him, God, give me that husband, wealthy and handsome, you know? Or give me that girlfriend, or give me that Tesla. What is the newest model? Are you pretending, you know? Okay. Give me that house, give me all this, give me that. Solve this situation, you know? Maybe in your heart it's like this, but in my heart during those hours, during those times, I only have one request. Because I think I'm so sinful, I think I'm dirty, I think I'm not worthy. So that when I see Jesus in my head, I only have one request. I say, Jesus, forgive my sin. That's all. And then the next sentence that he said, it blew my head away. He said that, I waited for you for a long time as to forgive you. Wow. He's not accusing me that, hey, I've been waiting for you for a long time. Why are you taking so long? No. He said, I'm waiting for you for a long time so that I can forgive you. He's not waiting for his sake, he's waiting for my sake. I will hear a counting. I will hear a number. That's how much he loves. We have to reroute our thinking. We have to relearn. We have to relearn what love is from God. At the end of this gospel reading, it seems so tough, right? The daughter-in-law against the mother-in-law seems like hers, but it's normal, you know? Or father-in-law and the son-in-law, you know? I don't know why mother-in-law always have problems with daughter-in-law and the son-in-law always have the father-in-law. Well, sometimes it's because of the mother-in-law, right? Chinese culture is a little bit different. Chinese culture is usually, because I think that the Caucasian culture would be the son-in-law have issue with the mother-in-law, right? And, right? You can say no, it's okay. But Jesus said that if you love your father and mother more than me, it's not worthy of me. It seems so tough. Jesus is asking us to make a choice, to make a bet. Actually, every day when you're making choices, you're making a bet. How do you invest something that you will lose anyway? Remember when Jesus threw a parable, there's a parable of an unjust housekeeper, unjust employer. Remember that? That parable? Saying that I'm going to fire you. You cannot be my employees anymore. So then what did he do? He sell everything cheap. Remember that parable? Jesus is asking us to do this because something that God give you every day and you will lose it anyway. Do you know what that is? Your time. You can choose to go in bed right now. You did. You choose to come here. Good investment. You can choose to be on your cell phone all the time and not look at your wife or your parents or your friend or choose. But the second, every second that you have, you cannot keep. Let's waste a second. I just wasted a second. But you know what? You can make a choice every day how you use that second to invest in eternity. How you do that? You walk in His kingdom. You walk in His kingdom, and when you walk in His kingdom, the investment will multiply. You will get His reward. You know what Jesus' reward is? This is, go back to my first point. It's a sermon that keep going back, so that we'll be here until Stephen come back. Who's your master? Your master, what is your master reward? Your master reward is will be become what? The children of God. The Son of God give you the reward as the children of God. That's why we call each other what? Brothers and sisters. Because that's our reward. That's who we are. And then Jesus said, well, what other things? He said, you will become kings sitting on the throne with Jesus Himself. That's the promise. So then you have to make a choice. How do you make choices every single day? Being a Christian is not to say a happy prayer, say, God, I receive you, you become my Savior, forgive my sin, and that's it. No. Every day, you're making a choice. When we men serving on the net, I don't know why it always happens. Sometimes, some negative woman pops up, and one of them pops up, you have to make a choice. When you're on your phone with your girlfriends, you start talking about some other wives, the gossiping, you have to make a choice. When you continue clicking that one-click Amazon, you know? Some of you know what I'm talking about, that's sad. And you already have like 50 boxes unopened in that storeroom. You have to make a choice. Every month when you get your paycheck, tithing, you have to make a choice. You didn't have a chance to make a choice. You couldn't make an altar call. This choice is two components. One, if you never before received Christ and you say that, wow, just loving God that Pastor Jackson said, I want to receive that. That's the second component is for you to make a choice and say that God, you're God, I am not. And I will follow you. I will be a full-time Christian from now on. It doesn't matter what I do. I may be a teacher. I may be a housekeeper. I may be a housewife. I may be a student. I may be an engineer. I may be a business. Whatever. That would be my temporary title for that job. But I'm a full-time Christian. I'm a full-time disciple. Yes.
I would invite somebody who can play the piano and give me some good music. Mm-hmm.
you for your love.
Thank you for loving us despite our conditions.
Yes.
Sometimes we don't even have the strength to receive. Sometimes we don't even have the strength to respond. And the Bible says sometimes even when we are against your love for us hasn't changed. So today, if you have never received Jesus as your Lord, want to raise your hand and say that Jesus is my Lord. Very simple. Raise your hand and say that Jesus is my Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Jesus. Say a simple prayer and say that Jesus, forgive my sin. I apologize. Just like all my children would do and say that I'm sorry that I will not do it again. And say, Jesus, you will be my master. I will follow you. And I believe in you. I believe you because you are the Son of God. Because you died for my sin. Because you rise again. Because you will come back. Thank you, Jesus. The second call was for the people. God is, now is trickling in your heart. Say that God, I will serve you full time. Not becoming a minister. Some of the ministers on earth, they are not serving God. But I want you to serve God in your jobs, in your homes, on the bus ride, in the marketplace, in the storm. And you say that God, I want to make the choice of being a full-time Christian. I want to raise your hand and say that God, take me. If you have raised your hand before, you can come up, just come up. It's not to let people see you, but it's an action that you remember. It's an action that you're showing the spiritual realm that you're making a choice. Supernatural.
ask God to fill them with love and strength. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's give a hand.
Thank you, Pastor Troy. Can we all stand and reaffirm our faith in the word of the Lord? We believe in one God,
the Father of all the armies, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified in the Moses' time. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again according to the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead. And his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy and Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world.
Please be seated for our next sessions. Father, we pray for your Holy Catholic Church.
That we all may be one.
Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you.
That your name may be glorified by all people.
We pray for all bishops, priests, deacons, especially for our Pastor Stephen as he continues his recovery, and our Archbishop Andrew.
May they be faithful ministers of the word and the sacraments.
We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world. Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake. Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble.
That they may be delivered from distress.
Give the departed eternal rest.
That life and peace be upon them forever.
We praise you for all your saints who have entered into joy.
May they also come to share in the heavenly kingdom.
Let's take a moment to pray for our own needs and the needs of others. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive what we have been, and amend what we are, and our what we shall be. That we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sin through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
We are the body of Christ. May the peace of the Lord may always be with you. Let's stand and greet each other in greeting. Let's remain standing as we sing our offertory hymn, Lord, I offer my life to you. Oh,
Blessed be God forever. Yours, Lord, the greatness, the power, the glory, the splendor, and the majesty. For everything in heaven on earth is yours. All things come from you, and of our own do we give you. Let's remain standing, and if you're with a family member, grab a hand as we pray as our Lord Christ taught us.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, the glory, and the truth, now and forever. Amen. Remain standing as we sing our closing hymn. I'm decided to follow Jesus.
Thank you. talking.